You can check this man out on the stand-up comedy circuit just next week. Yeah. In Phoenix, Arizona at Stand Up Live on December 28th and 30th. If you're in Oxnard, California, home of the Dallas Cowboys training camp, the 18th through the 21st at Levity Live, you can get tickets available at AdamRayComedy.com. The co-host of the About Last Night podcast as well, Adam Ray, here on the show. How are you, sir?
I'm great. Thank you for the plugs.
You know Brockman, who you know very well over there, has never seen About Last Night.
You never listened to my podcast?
No, he's never seen the movie.
Oh, the movie.
The movie.
About Last Night.
The movie. Wow. No idea.
Have you seen Air Bud 6?
Yes.
All right. Well, all is forgiven then.
Yeah, I'm in. Well, not on Air Bud.
But Air Bud, I have not seen Air Bud 6. Do you need to see the first 5 Air Buds in order to understand
Look,
Air Bud
I don't want to be the guy that says you don't.
You're not a naysayer, huh?
No, I feel like, but Air Bud, I mean, I think I saw the first 2 legitimately. I don't know in theaters, but where I was like genuinely pumped to be like, you know, everyone said this dog couldn't play ping pong. I would like to be the one to, you know.
You don't want to be the one to say nay to that sort of thing.
I don't think you have to. I think,
So now I'm looking at the S on your lid.
Yeah, this Die Hard Mariners. Even though we lost.
Old school Mariner right there.
Yeah, this is old school. And I think this is what you do as a fan when you lose out on a game-changing player. Ohtani.
Yeah.
See, but that's I don't care. That's basically what that was. Like he's not a Mariner. Yeah.
You're pissed that the guy that you don't even know his name didn't sign with you. That's fandom right there, by the way.
It really is. And you know what? At this point too, like we needed somebody like that to really help ticket sales. And I would like to take this moment to tell DePoto, our GM, like, hey, where's my DePoto camera?
DePoto cam is right there with
there
the
we
red
go, straight,
light on.
Yeah,
right
there we go.
Yeah.
Look, I think it's time. We got maybe a small window with some of these guys, and you're trying to like go for pitchers. You're like, we don't need any more hitters. You're wrong on that. And this is what I think this season should be. Let's bring back some of the old guys. This is a bring back Buehner campaign, okay? Put him in right field.
Buehner.
Oh, he can't run? Oh, do we care? Not really, dude. I'm trying to go see Buehner live. Okay, and he's not doing a one-man show anymore, or I don't know if he ever was.
Buehner Live is the worst metal of all time, I think.
From the producers of Sesame Street Live. Come Buehner Live. He just shaves kids' heads.
Buehner was great, man.
He was one of the best.
And also one of the best punchlines in the history of Seinfeld when Costanza's dad meets George Steinbrenner in the first, and George is potentially dead.
Yeah.
And George's dad says to Steinbrenner, what the hell did you trade Jay Buehner for? And then Larry David's voice saying, baseball people, my baseball people said Ken Phelps.
Ken Phelps.
Oh
Kenny
my
Phelps.
God. Who, by the way, was there when they when the S was on the hat, like the one that you have on right
It's amazing
now.
To think that how close the Mariners, like we would have been Seattle is for losing 2 franchises. Like the Mariners, had we not had that 95 season, they already apparently had Tampa Bay Mariner apparel printed up.
Huh.
And that would have been devastating. I mean, losing the Mariners and the Sonics, like.
Well, isn't Key Arena supposedly maybe getting set
they're making
to,
some
to
changes.
Welcome somebody back, either hockey or
hopefully.
Or
hockey,
NBA?
I think, is more likely. The NBA should happen because there's only so many Sue Bird jerseys I can buy. And I love the WNBA, but it's not what I grew up on. I grew up on Michael Cage and Detlef Schrempf. Nice. I'm looking to open a Schrempf's. You know, like a line of TGI Fridays, shrimps. And if you can pronounce it in one
what is
run,
in a
you
shrimps?
Get free appetizers.
What do you serve at shrimps?
Whatever you want. And this is the main question we get when people walk in because they go, "What is this place?
Yeah.
Is it a Lady Foot Locker spinoff, or is it a, or is it a Applebee's light? You can get anything. You can get a lot of milkshakes.
Okay.
A lot of like turkey meatloaves.
Okay.
Flat tops. They have a barbershop.
Oh, yeah. Dude, Shrimp did have a nice set of hair.
He had a nice
We had a good-looking team. By the way, your guys' talk about Enberg was really, it was perfect.
Thanks,
that guy,
man.
He was, no joke, probably my top 2 favorite commentators of all time, especially because the NBA is my favorite sport. And growing up, like when the Sonics got a lot of airplay, he was the guy for all the playoffs. Mm-hmm. And even he was the guy who called when Dikembe upset my Supersonics in the 8 seed over the 1-94.
The Nuggets, right?
Other than my parents' divorce, thanks for bringing that up, that was the worst day of my life, seeing Mutombo hold.
That like, ball on the ground.
If Mutombo, like, literally, like, even if, like, if I'd find out my parents got divorced, if Mutombo was holding the ball and was like, and Lance and Putin are no longer together, I would have been like, I don't care, man. Like, you just beat Kemp. And
he was waving the finger.
He waved the finger like, yeah, they don't love each other anymore. You know, but
I don't mean to joke about
No, that would actually
something
would be,
that obviously was a
dude.
A
that
difficult
would have softened the
life.
Blow if Mutombo came out to told any kid that his parents and he just
he's the official.
He shows up and when he does this. He doesn't even say anything. You just know that it's over. When
oh
he waves
no!
The
just here comes to here comes this large 7 foot man with a waving a finger to let me know about my, yeah. my parents' divorce.
But
Emberg, terrible.
But Emberg was the man through all that, and so and it made it you know that much more special to see your home team on the.
Adam
TV.
Ray here on the Rich Eisen Show. Speaking of Larry David,
yeah.
you were on an episode of Curb. You played one of the Uber drivers.
Yeah.
This came up yesterday. I was with a buddy of mine who was trying to put his credit card information in the Uber app, and it wasn't taken. He was
right.
getting all pissed off. I'm like, well, maybe your rating's terrible.
Yeah.
And we had that
People
whole
don't...
conversation about the Uber rating, like
That's
the episode
so
from Curb this,
yeah.
this year. What was that like being on the set with
Dude,
LD?
It was...
You were in a scene with him, flat-out scene with him.
A scene, and it's like, it was only a minute-long scene, which, you know, I think every actor, you know, like, you know, editing is out of your control, you know?
Right.
And we had so many funny riffs. I mean, you know, everything's improvised. So you have a couple nuggets of, like, we need to hit these beats. Like, at one point, Larry's going to ask you what his rating is, and you tell him he's a one. That's basically it.
That's
and the
it.
Rest is just open... forum for funny and you know in the audition I went in twice I did once as me once with an accent and made him just laugh a ton and he's behind me and you know it's my favorite show so I've watched it so much I kind of knew how to build a fight you know and like mm-hmm. give him kind of nuggets of funny and once he takes something and runs with it then I know I can and jump in mm-hmm. and we maybe did 9-10 takes and they were all pretty good and then like the last few were I think pretty exceptional and I walked away being like, all right, I think they got enough to really cut some. But you know, we had a great fight that it built to, but even getting a minute of airtime with them is
amazing.
It's pretty cool.
It's great. And then you can play a believable character from what I heard of
yeah.
the roast of David Ortiz at the House of Blues in Boston that has never made the light of air, right?
Yeah, I was gonna say it was so not safe for work. Clips?
It never made air.
Never got air.
You were there, Brockman, right,
there,
with Sarah.
Nessun was gonna air kind of like an hour cut
yeah.
down and when they went back and looked at the footage, it was so blue and X-rated, they couldn't air
Look
any
at that
of it.
Guy.
But you played...
That's me.
You got in a full...
Hopefully that's me
gray hair,
by age
mustache
42.
Getup
yeah.
and a Yankee jersey.
Yeah, so I was going to... I'm not a big... You know, I'm not a roast comic. Like, I definitely I do a lot of crowd work in my stand-up. And,
sure.
And, you know, so much so that I can handle, you know, I feel like anything at this point. And if, but I always try to kill people with kindness. And then if I have to slam them and really take care of things...
You'll do
I will
it.
After a while. But at that point, the audience is on my side to take care of it.
Sure.
But so when I got asked to do it, I was like, well, maybe I can do it as a character because, you know, I was on Mad TV and that's just kind of my thing. And I'll be more comfortable to roast people that way, make fun of Big Poppy if he doesn't know who I am.
So you played an older
totally.
New York Yankee
fan. So I flew out the woman who did, she did a makeup on SNL in the 90s and then this new season of Mad TV. And so I was like, can you make me unrecognizable? Like a, I don't know, 67-year-old Yankees fan. And I'll feel better to kind of make fun of these guys. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I laid it on Dustin Pedroia pretty hard, and like, you know, my jokes were just, you know, Dustin Pedroia is, you know, his natural position is second base, but or his real position is second base. But let's be honest, his natural position is dancing next to a pot of gold at the end of a rainbow, and then like, you know, Dustin looks like a kid who's or a dad whose parents call him by his first name. You know, like, kids, it's time for bed. You know, F you, Dustin. And I laid it on him pretty hard, and then he turned over to Josh Wolf, and he was like, dude, who is this old man? Like, this guy is such.
He was pissed.
Yeah, he was like, he's a dick, and and I was like, and Josh was like, no, he's my buddy Adam, he's a comedian, and then we started becoming Twitter friends, and now he's like, man, I want to come see you do stand-up, and the last two times we've messaged, he said he was out of town for a vacation and his anniversary, and I'm like, dude, just tell me you don't want to see me, because these excuses are really starting to get lame. Oh, family, I'm married, you know. No, you're a good dude. We'll hang out soon.
Yeah.
Quiznos
Careful,
on me.
Careful, we're on in Arizona, too.
Are you really?
Oh, yeah.
No, Pedroia's the man, you know, and he can really take a joke, like some... You hear some of these athletes and see them too that just can't laugh at themselves. But Poppy too. I mean, I said he was like the Dominican Babe Ruth, and it looks like he ate all the baby Ruths. I'm butchering the joke.
No,
this is why Nessun didn't air it. They were like, dude, do you even know what you're saying?
I was at a Baseball Writers Association dinner. Bill Schecht, the comedian,
yeah.
you know, who's a
yeah, yeah.
Letterman writer for so many years, he laid waste the entire day as filled with Yankees and said the joke that Chuck Knobloch, man. His aim is so bad, we should send him to Cuba to overthrow Castro.
Whoa.
And the whole day, George Steinbrenner was on the dais, and Clemens, and Torrey, and Jeter, and Cohn, and Wells, all of them were on the dais, and Torrey sitting next to Steinbrenner were stone-faced, and the other guys were on the other side of the dais, like with their hands over their mouth, like diving for cover underneath the table.
No, they loved it.
Oh, they did, but they couldn't act like it. Some of these guys don't have a sense of humor.
Yeah, I wish they would have aired it, but there was so much, you know, they really slammed Gronk, TMZ did. For,
yeah, I heard that, right?
But it was, you know, he was the most clickable bait. You know, if they had put like, Adam Ray makes fun of Dominicans and blacks and Jews, they would have been like, who? Right. Air it.
And
he,
his set was so tame compared to everyone
else. It was.
Well, look, roasts are blue. That's the way it should work.
Exactly.
At Adam Ray Comedy on Twitter. I want to take a break. Come back. I want to take some of these phone calls.
Oh, yeah.
You have a take on whether Die Hard's a Christmas movie or not? Or if you do, we can hold it.
I don't think it is. I think.
Oh, boy. See,
I think
it's not.
It's not.
And I've got, by the way, let's take a break. Coming back in 60 seconds, I have the end of this conversation.
Oh, geez.
This is going to be the end. We're going to end the conversation. I have a piece of information that will end it.
It's like saying Lethal Weapon's a Hanukkah movie.
Correct. Right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Exactly.
Because it lasted eight
and
days,
Mel Gibson,
right?
That's right. Loves our people. So.
Mel loves the oil.
Has he been on the show? Can we call into Mel real quick and see what his take on Shabbat is?
We'll reveal our responses to the Friday pitch rich question of names of college bowl games rejected because they were too long. That's coming up next here on the Rich Eisen Show. Welcome back to the Rich Eisen Show. Adam Ray, comedian Adam Ray, actor Adam Ray is chilling out with us here on the program. The poll question as it currently stands brought to you by HGTV. Chris Brockman, go for it.
Yeah, is Die Hard a Christmas movie? Sorry, guys. 63%. Or on the good guy team, me. Yes. Mm. Die Hard, a Christmas movie.
Dave in New York, you're here on the show. What's up, Dave?
Oh, you first there? Of all, what an honor it is to talk with you.
Thank you, Dave.
Thanks, Dave. Great. No, Rich, yeah. All good, Dave. I'm here too,
and
man.
I started watching you. I know you're short, but I started watching you when you were on Dan Patrick. Okay. And then I just followed you over onto your own show and a well-deserved show.
Thank you. Really appreciate that.
Dan Patrick is, and his crew are awesome, but you guys, you're holding your own. It's a great show.
Thanks, Dave, and we love the DP crew as well. Thanks for saying
that. You're welcome. So, anyways, yes, Die Hard is a Christmas show.
What are you, a Christmas show?
No, he's just
Dave, what are you on right now?
It's not a show like a weekly show, sorry. But it's a movie about Christmas that...
What did you say?
It's a movie about Christmas. Why is it a Christmas movie, Dave?
Okay. Because it's focused around Christmas, it's a feeling. It's more of how people from all different walks of life look at Christmas. Uh-huh. And I think everybody in the world could relate to that.
Dave, I appreciate your call and what you said about this show. I'm going to have to respectfully disagree with you.
Yeah. And I'm just going to have to disagree with you, disrespectfully, because I don't think it's a Christmas movie,
it
Dave.
It is not a Christmas movie.
Yeah, there's too much action. What, you know...
No, Christmas movies are...
Have you seen the ABC Family movies with, like, Mario Lopez and Shaq and Candace Cameron, where it's like, Jared was only 7 and loved Christmas more than anything, and then his best friend threw his chinchilla in the fire, and Santa helped him get it back, get a new chinchilla. Like, that's a Christmas movie.
Yes.
Yeah.
In a way.
Kind of,
I'd go a Miracle on 34th Street.
Totally.
You know?
But if Mario Lopez is in it, it's probably holiday themed.
Hans Gruber is not in It's a Wonderful Life.
No, thank you.
That's correct.
you can argue that he's the guy who shuts down Bailey's Savings and Loans.
Newton in Richmond, Virginia, you're here on the Rich Eisen Show. What's up, Newton?
Well, first of all, happy holidays to the world that's listening.
Thank you. Same to the world.
I don't believe it's a Christmas movie, but here's some points that shoot holes in that theory, and a small couple of corrections.
Okay.
First small correction is, it wasn't a movie about terrorists taking over a building. It was a movie about a heist. They were stealing marijuana.
All right. Okay?
Secondly, if you put the theory of, if you take the Christmas element out of it, will it still be a movie? Well, unfortunately, we have to say you can't, because the premise was that John was on his way back to see his family and his maybe ex-wife, because they aren't divorced yet, and the whole theme of him visiting at Christmas and the spirit of Christmas around that gives way to some people who like Bloody Christmas to think that this could be, on some level, a Christmas movie. And with that togetherness at the end, how he triumphs and fights an entire group of terrorists just to be with his family at Christmas, it kind of does it.
Newton in Richmond, Virginia.
I don't think it is, but you have to give some merit to their argument.
Newton, I hope you have that monologue tattooed on your lower back, because that is a very passionate statement.
Contortion as well. Yeah. That's what everybody's been trying to contort to make it a Christmas movie. Yeah. Here, I'm going to end this.
I know where you're going. Okay. Yeah.
Die Hard, supposed Christmas movie.
Of course, say it.
That has no Christmas images on its movie poster mm-hmm. whatsoever, was released on July 15th.
Thank you.
1988.
Big Willy weekend.
If it is a Christmas movie in the eyes of the filmmakers and the studio, they do not release it after July 4th.
Case in point.
In the same month as July 4th.
You're right. Yep. Because film studios have a great track record of when to release movies.
Stop. All right.
You are not releasing. You're releasing an action movie in the summer. Yep. Not a Christmas movie.
Yeah.
In the summer. You are releasing a Christmas movie in December.
Why would you release an action movie set around Christmas in July? That's just bad on the movie producers and the film studio.
Speaking of which, how come we don't have any? How, like, when somebody said Home Alone is an invasion movie, it's not a Christmas movie, which I loved. We never get Hanukkah as the backdrop to any of these stories. Like, Kevin McAllister could have, missed the flight. They were going to see Gloria and Max,
for Hanukkah.
Blomstein.
Yeah.
And then, he's home alone. He's like, how am I going to light the menorah all by myself? Right. Only six candles,
Yeah, they could have been, instead of a Christmas story with a Red Ryder rifle, it could have been a Passover story with a matzah braai.
Yeah.
I'm just spitballing.
You're spitballing, but you're also exactly right.
Let's get to our Pitch Friday results. Shall we do that?
Let's do it.
Okay, here on the Rich Eisen Show, every single week we have this fun endeavor with our friends at Funny or Die, where we give away an invitation to their app, the Pitch app, that is writers and comics only. They pay for jokes on there, so you can start a career in writing jokes and getting paid for it.
Did you hear that, George, my stepdad?
There you go.
Your puns have a place to live now.
There we go. And this week's thread that we asked you to give your best answer to the hashtag of Pitch Rich, the Pitch Friday topic, college football bowl games that were rejected for being too long. And Adam Ray is sitting right next to us with the drum roll, please. Number five. The nighttime sniffling, sneezing, coughing, aching, stuffy head fever so you can rest bowl. Rejected.
That's NyQuil, right?
Number four. The Jason, if you're watching this, I spent all your savings on the naming rights to this game, and I'm leaving you bowl. That's number four.
That's harsh.
Number three, the Hey, why don't you play another Somebody Done Somebody Wrong song bowl? Very rare BJ Thomas reference here on the show. Very good. Number two, Cromartie Family Bowl presented by Antonio Jersey, Karis, Marie, Leilani, Tyler J., Julian Jagger, Antonio Jr., Deja, Alonzo, and London Cromartie.
Wow.
And then many Cromarties.
Yeah, so many Cromarties.
That's why it was rejected.
Yeah.
And the number one college football bowl game rejected for being too long. The Orange You Glad We Didn't Name This Game Banana Bowl.
Wow. Old school.
Oh, man.
By Sarah Rogers in Los Angeles, California.
Love it.
Dude, that's a playground deep cut right there.
I kind of dig that one. The listener viewer submission, the Pitch app submission and invitation goes to Ryan Jacobs at @_RyanJacobs gave you the Derek Zoolander Bowl for teams who can't play good and also can't read good, but also want to play in a bowl game and other stuff too good bowl game.
Oh, that's a good one. I'm a fan of any Zoolander reference.
There you go. That's Zoolander reference gets somebody a Pitch app invitation.
Love it.
There you go. Thanks for coming on, brother.
This was the blast. Thank you for having me.
Anytime. Come on back.
Thank you, buddy.
For more Rich Eisen Show, tune to Audience Channel 239 on DirecTV or download the Rich Eisen Show app.